Welcome. This is a preview video for Lecture 5. We're going to cover tissues we find in the human body. The learning objectives will cover the four tissues, we'll build some organs, and then we'll focus on epithelial and connective tissues today, and in class as well. The four major types of tissues, and again, these are just what scientists have tried to categorize everything into, are epithelial tissues, and also muscle tissue, nervous tissue, and connective tissue. And some of these might be obvious what they do, others maybe not. Muscle tissue includes skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, and smooth muscle. And muscle tissue probably doesn't surprise you that it is there to contract. And when these cells contract, they will cause movement. In the case of the heart, they move blood. Skeletal muscle moves your body. Smooth muscle could change the shape of, say, your stomach and move your food around. So that's muscle tissue. Nervous tissue includes the brain, spinal cord, and nerves. The cells that we know most about are the neurons, but also the support cells include nervous tissue as well. So we'll learn about those support cells as well. And neurons, you probably know, they have little electrical impulses. So the next one is epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue, I like to remember these tissues as covering tissues or lining tissues. So your skin on the outside of your cheek is an epithelial tissue, but also the cover on the inside of your mouth is an epithelial tissue. You can imagine the heart. The heart has an outside cover and an inside layer, and so both of those are covered by epithelial tissues. Connective tissue is sort of the space filler, the support, the organization, and the strength of all the tissue or all the organs of our body. And so connective tissue cells will include fibroblasts, fat cells. Also, there's lots and lots of fibers that the cells build called collagen fibers and elastic fibers. So we'll learn more about those. So those are the four tissue types, and we will build some organs with those so you could see how they are organized and how they help each other out. So remember, tissue is a group of cells, and then we can take tissues and make organs. The first organ we're going to build is the heart wall. And so the heart, again, pumps blood around the body. So we're going to focus here at the tissue level, but remember, tissues are just made of cells. Remember, the heart will have an inside layer and an outside layer. So we'll build the heart wall, and we'll draw that sort of outline of the inside and the outside of the heart wall. So on one side of the heart, we have the blood, where the blood actually touches the heart. That's the inside. And then if you were to put your finger on the outside of the heart, that's the outside. So the first thing we build is some epithelial tissue. So we put epithelial cells, and we cover the inside of the heart with a single cell layer of epithelial cells. It's just one cell layer thick, the lining of the heart. So that would be the lining of the heart. Or if you want to think of it, the cover on the inside of the heart. So that's one cell layer thick. We call that epithelium, singular, or epithelia, plural. And on the outside surface of the heart, we're going to add another single layer of cells, and that's, again, epithelium. Each one of those little cells is an epithelial cell. It's just one cell layer thick on the outside of the heart, and this is for protection and also just to have a nice smooth lining. We need to hold those epithelial cells to our heart, and that's where connective tissue will come in. Connective tissue will give strength, hold the various cells to the various other layers of tissue. And so here we draw a fibroblast, because fibroblasts are our favorite connective tissue cell. It will build fibers, protein fibrous networks. One of the more prevalent protein fibers is collagen protein. Also, elastin is another one. The epithelial cells and the connective tissue cells will also build something called the basement membrane. It's a protein network that holds specifically epithelial tissue to connective tissue. So that's really important. And so since we had epithelium on the outside surface of our heart, we need some connective tissue. We draw the basement membrane. So all those proteins will help add strength to that epithelium and also hold or connect that epithelium to the other tissue layers in the heart. So those are our connective tissues associated with our epithelium. Since the heart has a bunch of muscle in the middle there, it needs support. So we actually draw connective tissue throughout the heart wall. And so I'm just drawing protein fibers like collagen and elastin and various connective tissue proteins to give the heart wall strength. And those are found throughout the heart wall. So we could draw some fibroblasts anywhere we have connective tissue. And now we're going to actually draw the muscle layer of the heart. So we would call those myocytes, cardiac myocytes. Those little myocytes, when they contract, help increase pressure, which pumps blood. And so we draw those in the middle layer here in the middle of the heart. Those little cells have a nucleus, so we can draw a nucleus in there. And they're all bound together and connected together. Again, they're supported by the connective tissue fibers that help strengthen them and give them organization. Okay, so we've got epithelium on the outside and the inside. We've got connective tissue holding everything together. And then we've got muscle sandwiched in the middle, which allows the heart to contract. We'd even have nervous tissue in there in order to influence the heart rate and how hard it pumps as well. Just to remind you about lab, if we were to draw the heart wall and then add that plastic bag around it, we'd have the parietal pericardium, and we already drew the visceral pericardium. It was that single cell layer epithelium on the outside and the connective tissue underneath it. So just to relate that back to lab. Let's make a urinary bladder. You can guess that it holds pee. And so we have an inside that we need to line, and we have an outside that we need to cover as well. And so we do that with epithelium and different types of epithelium for different organs. We'll learn more about that. We need our connective tissue to hold everything together, and then some smooth muscle in this case in order to contract if we want to get rid of our pee. So again, epithelial cells, connective tissue cells like fibroblasts, and then smooth muscle cells. Connective tissue has lots of those protein fibers, elastin and collagen. Smooth muscle cells, when they contract, they make the bladder squeeze and they push the pee out and you urinate. And so that's the bladder. Again, the four tissue types. We'd even have nervous tissue in there too as well. Finally, I wanted to draw as quickly as we can the skin. So remember, the skin as well has an outer exposed layer, and then of course the inside of your skin is exposed to the inside of your body. So we need epithelium, and the epithelium covers our outer portion of our skin. Of course, those are the outer layer that you touch with your finger are dead epithelial cells. We have stem cells at the bottom of that epithelial layer, and we'll learn later that this is called the epidermis. Probably the thickest layer of your skin is actually connective tissue. And this is underneath, of course, the epithelium. It helps hold the epithelium to the rest of your body, the epidermis. And so we have lots and lots of collagen fibers. We need to draw a little basement membrane in there to hold the epithelial cells to the connective tissue. We draw some elastin and collagen to make your skin flexible and strong. And so we call that layer of our skin the thickest layer, the connective tissue layer of the skin, the dermis. We'll learn more about the skin in a separate lecture. We need to add some cushion and some fat and some space filler. So we draw some adipose tissue, some adipocytes. That's the subcutaneous layer. Sometimes it's called the hypodermis, but we'll learn more about that in skin. But adipose tissue really is just connective tissue with some fat cells in there. We can even draw some hairs and some glands, which are actually epithelial tissue, and we can even draw some nerves in there. So that's the skin. Again, it's got epithelial connective tissue, and that's your basic skin structure. Okay. The next learning objective is to describe the characteristics of epithelial tissues, or epithelium. Basically, you have lots and lots of cells in a layer, and they're going to be a cover or a lining. But they also have some characteristics in common, no matter what epithelia in the body we talk about, whether it's a stomach or the heart or the skin outer layer. First is that the cells have polarity. What does that mean? It means one side of the cell is different from the other side of the cell. And why is that important? Well, remember, in epithelia, one side of the cells are exposed to different things than the inside of the other side of the cells. One is attached to a basement membrane and connective tissue. The other one is exposed. So we call one side the apical surface, the exposed side, and the inner side, the one connected to the connective tissue, the basal side. So And these have different functions. So imagine you were talking about your stomach epithelium, your stomach lining. One side of the cells has to be pumping acid inside to the interior of your stomach to digest food, but we certainly don't want the other, the basal side, to pump acid because that would then digest the inside of your body. So it's important that those cells have polarity. So remember the terms apical and basal. Okay, the next feature of most epithelia is that they don't have blood vessels. Because they're so tightly packed with cells, there's no room for blood vessels. So they get their blood supply from the connective tissue, which does have blood vessels. So the connective tissue underneath supplies things like oxygen and glucose and takes away waste products. So avascular. The other thing about epithelium is because they're constantly needing to regenerate, they're always growing or dividing, so we have cell proliferation or regeneration. The outer cells, the apical cells, will die off through something called apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. So we need to have a layer of stem cells to help regrow our epithelium. So like your skin and your stomach lining, they regrow really fast. So those stem cells make new cells, those new cells mature, and then eventually they live for a little while and die. And remember, they die off from this thing called apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. So they're programmed to live and then die, and sometimes they don't die and they grow out of control, and that's why epithelial cells can sometimes, or epithelial tissues, can sometimes lead to cancer. So most of the cancers you've heard of are epithelial derived, and this word, if you've ever heard of it, carcinoma, really just refers to the fact that describes cancers that come from epithelial cells. Glands are epithelial cells, so things like the glands in the breast and the prostate gland, those are actual glands, are epithelial. So common cancers are derived from epithelia. Okay, the next learning objective, and we'll practice more of this in lab, is to classify the types of epithelium we see in the body. And again, we'll do more of this in lab, but I wanted to give you a little bit of a head start here with this. So remember, we always have connective tissue if we're going to have epithelium. So we'll always draw some connective tissue to support our epithelium. So we're drawing our epithelial cells. In this case, we're drawing some flat cells, and we draw a single cell layer, or we can stack our epithelial cells. So sometimes we have just one cell layer of epithelium. Other times we have many cell layers of epithelium. And so we have words to describe these. When there's one cell layer, we call it simple. When there's many cell layers, we call it stratified. And so we already looked at examples in the heart, and both those examples were simple epithelium, right? Single cell layers. So here we can also find different shapes of epithelial cells. So here we've drawn some flat ones, some square ones, and some rectangular ones. So shape of epithelia range from squamous or flat, kind of like the ones we saw in the heart, to cubes, which we'll see mostly in the kidney and bladder, and then columnar ones, which we'll see in places like the respiratory tract and the digestive tract. So epithelial cells can come in columnar, cuboidal, or squamous shape. So what about the skin? If we draw some of them, we see the dead cells, they look kind of flat, and the mature cells are kind of flat, but the stem cells, they're kind of square or cubed. So really, because the mature ones are flat, we call it squamous. And because it's stacked or many layers, we call it stratified squamous epithelium. So again, this is just an example of how we describe epithelia based on how many layers we see and also the shape. I wanted to give you another example that we're going to see a lot in this class and in lab. And this is in the lungs, for example, the trachea, your windpipe, and the bronchi, also inside your nose in your nasal cavity. We've got these long columnar cells with tons of cilia that move around mucus. But one of the things, so it's easy to kind of tell the shape. They're columnar. They're like rectangles. But when people try to figure out, are they layered or not, they got a little confused. And they're like, well, some of them look simple and columnar, and some of them look stratified, meaning stacked, and columnar. So they came up with this term pseudostratified, meaning fake layered. So pseudostratified columnar epithelium is typically found in your respiratory tract. We'll talk more about that as we go through the semester. Okay, so we'll do more of this in lab, where you practice actually determining whether they're simple or stratified, and then squamous, columnar, or cuboidal. All right, let's switch to connective tissue now. So remember, every time we were drawing epithelium, we were drawing connective tissue to support it. So connective tissue basically just has less cells than epithelium, but it's got a lot more of these extracellular protein fibers, for example, collagen and also elastin. These protein fibers or networks give connective tissue its strength. And the most famous connective tissue cell is the fibroblast. And so the fibroblast makes those fibers, at least in most of the connective tissue we've learned so far. All right, so regular connective tissue, some textbooks call it connective tissue proper is sort of what we've been drawing here, supporting epithelium. And so we can draw some examples of it. We can draw the fibers. We can draw the collagen fibers, the elastin fibers, and then we'll draw some cells in there. Again, the fibroblast is the typical connective tissue, regular connective tissue cell, and it builds those fibers. We can also throw in some adipocytes or fat cells, because those are commonly found mixed into our connective tissue. And so adipose tissue is actually a kind of connective tissue. The dermis, all those epithelial layers were supported by connective tissue. That's connective tissue, regular connective tissue. Tendons and ligaments are regular connective tissue. So connective tissue can range from really, really dense and strong to more loose and cushiony, just depending on how many fibers and adipocytes you have in there. So we'll learn more of these as we go throughout the class. The key to remember is that you have these protein networks like collagen and elastin, and then you have like the fibroblast that builds it. You may have some adipocytes thrown in there too. Okay, not so regular connective tissue. What would be these examples? Well, bone is considered connective tissue. Cartilage is considered connective tissue. So you're basically your skeletal tissues are considered connective tissue. Cartilage is also found not only at the ends of your bones, but in your ears and your nose as well. Blood is thrown into the connective tissue category as well. So blood, remember, erythrocytes and leukocytes and the plasma that supports it. I don't know if they just couldn't find another category. So blood is connective tissue as well. All right, and you know bone has bone marrow, which actually makes your blood. So a lot of that is thrown into the connective tissue category. So what does connective tissue do? Well, it's the most widely abundant tissue in the body. It's in every organ. It has to support everything, protect, and hold stuff together. Again, the fibroblast is the most famous and versatile connective tissue cell, but there's other special ones. The fibroblast can make those collagen fibers, which help support and add strength, and elastin fibers or elastic fibers, which add elasticity, right? Allows your organs to kind of stretch and then snap back. And so those are some examples of connective tissue. Again, every chapter we'll learn different organs and we'll learn about more of these tissues. Just to give you an idea of some of the other connective tissue cells, I wanted to remind you, fat cells are adipocytes. Osteocyte is a bone cell. One we haven't learned yet is chondrocyte, which is a cartilage cell. Red blood and cartilage, again, chondrocyte. Erythrocyte is a red blood cell, and a leukocyte is a white blood cell. Again, these would all be examples of connective tissue cells as well, just not the famous one, the fibroblast. Okay, the general components of connective tissue are cells, and I think we've got that covered. So remember fibroblasts and friends. What about this thing we call extracellular matrix? This is really just the stuff the connective tissue cells make and build, and because it's outside the cells, we call it extracellular. Because it's a network, we call it matrix. So extracellular matrix is simply the stuff outside the cells that the cells build. So for example, if you have a fibroblast in the dermis of your skin, it's going to make collagen and it's going to make elastin, protein network, and we'll call that extracellular matrix. If we're talking about a chondrocyte, or a chondroblast, actually, a chondroblast builds the cartilage. When it builds the cartilage, it's building it out of collagen and elastin as well. So again, extracellular matrix is just a term for this extracellular material that the cells build. Okay, that's the end. See you in class.